What's up, everybody? This is Master G Theater, and I am your host, Master G, and I am joined by the most incredible people this side of the cool side of the hip side of the flip side.
Oh, my God.
Here we go.
Oh, here we go. Let's go.
We got my man, DJ Boom. What's up,
bro? I still reside on the show.
Yes, you do, and we got the lovely COB.
Peace and love, fam.
Hey, RBI!
What up, what up?
Hey, listen, you know this, thanks to all the hip-hop heads and all the people that's coming out. Oh, of course, it's me. Did I miss anybody?
No.
Okay, good. Just making sure. Because you're looking at me like I did something wrong.
No.
So I was like, I got to make sure I'm doing the right thing. You know, it's been a few weeks since I've been able to, you know, been here hosting the show. So.
And we brought you back.
Yes.
For like the biggest announcement
right.
Like, the museum has ever made.
Like literally, I got here last night, you know, because I was out on the West Coast.
Just doing the halftime show for the Dallas Cowboys.
Yeah,
no big deal.
Yeah, I just did the 49ers and the Cowboys at Levi Stadium. And I'm leaving back out tomorrow because I'm on my way to San Diego via New York. So I had to come here before the announcement. And then, of course, I had to come here for our guest today.
Yes.
Well, we have the most amazing guest today because our guest today is right. One of the next inductees at the National Hip Hop Museum. Ooh. We have the one, the only Kool Rock Ski in the building.
What up, what up, what up?
So, yeah, so those of you that watch the show, thank you for watching the show. Those of you who are tuning in or checking it out, this is what you're going to get. You're going to get the lovely, you're going to get the cold-blooded, you're going to get the cool, you're going to get the fly, and then you're going to get...
You're going to get Marcus.
And Marcus.
See, and then you get Marcus.
Without further ado... Yes. Before we go to the hands of God, I want to let you know about the National Celebration of Hip Hop.
Make the announcement.
October 28th here in Washington, D.C., the biggest hip hop show to ever hit our nation's capital. We will be performing and inducting Ice-T, the Sugar Hill Gang, Curtis Blow, Flava Flav, Terminator X, Hurricane. We already inducted Sugar Hill Gang. DMC, Rozelle, Kool Rock Ski, MC Shaw Rock, Roxanne Shantae, Melly Melon Scorpio, Mad Skills, Kid and Play, Soul Sonic Force, CL Smooth, Peter Guns, DJ Kevy Kev Rockwell, Busy Beat, Joski Love, Positive K, and many, many more. Donald D, of course, will also be inducted as part of the B-Boys. Oh my God, October 28th.
That's
here.
Insane.
Get your tickets now. NationalCelebrationOfHipHop.com. After this break, that was a lot of
caffeine. We can clip that for the radio.
After this break, we will be coming back with one-third of the Disco 3, one-third of the Fat Boys, the next inductee at the National Hip Hop Museum, Kool Rock Ski. But until then, RBI, take it away.
Take it away.
Hands of God.
Shot with 1,000 beats for every day of the week. So come
I'm a beatbox, play one for me.
We're back. It's amazing.
It's amazing.
We're back with Guy Jr. is in the building.
Guy Jr.
What's up, Guy Jr.?
Master G Theater, you are on the radio. Sirius XM 141 and 142. Guy Anthony O'Brien Jr., ladies and gentlemen.
Hey! What's up, Guy Jr.?
We call him Face, because look at that face.
Look at that handsome face.
Right?
With those beautiful teeth.
Yeah. Oh, beautiful face, right? I call him Face.
That's what a handsome kid.
What up, Face? You all right? Yo.
This is actually my favorite Fat Boy song of all time.
Yeah.
Can you feel it? Who sang this?
It joints, man. Who sang the vocals? I'm not sure. Maybe Allison Williams?
Right, we'll have to ask.
Yo, G is having a whole conversation over there.
This is the wildest show ever. We have two guests.
We're keeping this in
G's
the show.
G's show and
I talk to you later,
Cool Rock Ski.
I love you.
Look at that.
I love you.
Let's go to our guest.
That's the greatest thing in the world, man.
Inductee at the National Hip Hop Museum, performing with Rozelle at the National Celebration of Hip Hop. The one,
the
only, Cool Rock Ski and the Fat Boy.
What up? How y'all doing?
Hey, man. Let me just say that this is our first kind of like somewhat kind of meeting, but I just want to tell you, man. Always been a fan. I love everything that you and the brothers have done. I think that it's an incredible situation, your legacy, the impact that you've had on the music and the culture is one to be recognized and acknowledged. And so I just want to take this time to say thank you, man, because I know, you know, you got many choices of shows that you could be on. And for you to choose the Master G Theater, I am humbled and I am truly honored. So thank you.
Oh man, I mean, it's an honor just to, you know, to meet you and talk to you. It's dope. You know, it's one of the MCs, rappers that put hip hop on the map and made a lot of us, you know, not just us, but a lot of us pick up a microphone and just want to do what you guys did. You know, you blazed the trail. You set the whole precedent for this whole hip hop culture.
Thank you.
So, you know, we're grateful to you. And, you know, Big Bank Hank, may he rest in peace.
Yes.
And you know, Wonder Mike.
Yes.
So you guys are definitely the trendsetters, you know, the epitome of this whole hip-hop culture.
Thank you, man.
Well,
really.
Speaking of the epitome, we kind of always start out with this one question, but it often leads to the same place. Can you recall, Cool Rock Ski, the very first hip-hop song you can remember ever hearing?
It was the, you know what, I went back and forth with a few people about this. King Tim III, and then
that was the first one.
That was Delight.
Yeah,
that was the first. Yeah, so that would be the first one. But you know what? You're hearing King Tim III, but you're listening to it as somebody like your uncle,
right,
on the porch just rapping.
Right.
You know, just we called it rhyming back then.
Right. Exactly.
Just rhyming. But then when Rappers Delight came out, we were like, oh yeah, now this is more, you know what I'm saying? This is more like it, you know what I mean?
But you know what? You know what it is though? Here's the thing about King Tim and that. That was a rap being done on a R&B song.
Oh,
R&B? Fatback is an R&B
not
band.
Disco. Okay.
So it was a rap being done on an R&B song. Rappers Delight is the first rap record.
Right.
Right, it was all rapping. So that's what it is. So like you said, Ski said, you know, like a lot of our older people, uncles, whatever, they were fans of Fatback Band. So when the record came out,
they were like, oh.
The rap happened to be on there. They kind of did it. But when Rappers Delight came out, it was a complete rap record. That's what really got people, you know, that's why it kind of, and unfortunately it did, it kind of overshadowed the King Tim record because it was such a general right on the jugular vein of rapping.
And musically too
because
had great music.
So yeah. That was cool. Thank you.
Not
man.
To mention it was rapped over one of the hottest songs on the street.
Summer Joint. It was the Summer Joint. That was premeditated.
Cool Rock, I want to take this opportunity right now to publicly congratulate you.
Yes.
because as the founder of the National Hip Hop Museum and our
and
executive,
I am the executive director of the National Hip Hop Museum,
excuse
me. I just want to also, along with my business partners and associates and Marcus, and I just want to talk to you and thank you.
No, proceed, I mean, congrats. Listen,
proceed, sir. I mean,
it's hard to take it seriously when our executive director's a
yes.
ham.
But you know what's executive? No.
You know what's amazing is that you know Curtis Blow is also being inducted.
Ah, good guy.
Yeah.
And let's talk a little bit about Kool Rock Ski, about your guys' relationship with Curtis Blow, who arguably had a very important hand in the success of the Fat Boys. Can you tell us a little bit about why that was?
Our first single, which was called Reality, after we won the rap contest back in 1983, we won a rap and dance contest. I think it was promoted by WBLS.
Wow.
And the first place prize was a recording contract. So we won the semifinals at the Disco Fever, and we won the finals at the Radio City Music Hall.
Wow.
So we made our first song, which was called Reality. And at that time, everybody's making these kind of message conscious kind of songs because they was harping on what Flash and the Furious Five did, featuring Duke Booty with The Message. And so we thought we'd make our rendition of it. So I think it sold like maybe, if it sold 2,000 copies, that was 2,000 copies too many. So yeah, the song was horrible. So,
wait, so you're saying it exists on vinyl though?
Yeah, unfortunately exists.
I got a copy of that thing. I'm gonna bring it for you to sign.
Yes, please.
Gosh. And this is on the Sutra label. See, we was under like Morris Levy at that time.
Unlucky you.
Yeah.
I mean, I know I got some Morris Levy stories, but I won't tell you.
Yeah, you know Master G does.
I knew Mr. Levy really well. But anyway, go ahead.
And so we kind of regrouped. So our manager, Charles Stettler, he became our manager after the contest.
Oh, okay.
And so he went and got Curtis Blow. We didn't believe him because we was kind of like just, we kind of gave up on it, to be honest with you. We kind of went back into going into, we was entering high school. So we kind of just said, you know what, let's just finish school. And, you know, we gave it a try, whatever. So we get the phone call to come to Quadrasonic Studios, the famous Quadrasonic Studios.
Yes, sir.
And in the studio was Curtis Blow. White jacket, Jerry curls dripping down, and with the K Blow nameplate, we was in awe. We was looking at him like, "Yo, this is really Curtis Blow." And so
you're like, "Charlie wasn't lying."
Yeah, Charlie wasn't lying. So he had the track already done, the chorus and everything. We just had to write the rhymes. So we wrote the rhymes, and that same night we did "Put It Up, Stick 'Em." That same night. After we did the Fat Boy song, and the song was released. It was released while we were still in high school. So, and I always tell people this story, like, if you're the big man on campus in high school, playing football or basketball, whatever sport, just imagine you're a 16-year-old kid going to high school, and you know, you got a hit record, you know what I'm saying? So it's like quadruple times a basketball what a football player is in high school. So the song was a hit. The song came like on a Friday. So by the time we got back to school on Monday, it was like hysteria in school. So we just, it took off from there. The song Fat Boys took off from there.
Yes. I have a small idea of what it feels like to release a record when you're going to the 12th grade in high school.
Right.
So I feel you. I truly do feel you. And not very many people know what that feels like, but you just explained it the best way. It's bigger than being the basketball star, is bigger than being the football, the quarterback. It's bigger than all of that combined. Am I right? That adulation you get from the crowd when you got a record on the radio in high school.
Oh man!
What?
Yeah.
On BLS? What?
Yeah, you don't have to try for the football team or basketball team anymore.
Nothing.
The cheerleaders are going to come to you.
You got a you got a problem. You got your problem is what do you do with all the things that's going on?
So the principal announced on the loudspeaker, and you know it was kids in our classrooms trying to get in our homeroom.
Right.
We was following around like that whole week that song came out.
Cool.
It was just crazy.
Very cool. Very, very cool.
So I just have to ask, because this is really important. So thanks to you, Cool Rock Ski, the National Hip Hop Museum maintains like a really large collection of Fat Boy's costumes.
Oh, yeah. Oh cool. Oh, yeah.
Okay. Specifically, we have some of your guys' costumes from Jailhouse Rap.
Wow.
Wow.
Jailhouse Rap. Yes. Well, no, hold on. Let me. You tell us the significance of Jailhouse Rap.
Oh, once again, a Curtis Blow song. It was simple with Curtis Blow. He put down the music. He would have the chorus already, and all he needed for me and Marky D was to write the rhymes. But to be honest with you, the Jailhouse Rap wasn't what you heard on the radio or in the video. Mm. It was real, real hardcore because we talk about jail. So we're rapping about jail. So we're rapping about shooting cops in the back and having fights with our old man, that kind of stuff. So,
where does this version exist?
Right.
Yeah, it doesn't. If Curtis Blow can find that and put it out, we'll probably be gangster rappers overnight. But
you literally recorded that version?
Did you record that version?
We recorded it, but it went back to Charlie. Charlie heard it, and he was like, yeah, we can't use that. We got this fun song.
It's crazy, because y'all would have beat Schoolie D by like a year.
Right?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah, it was real hardcore. And so, yeah, the record company was like, nah, we're not using that. So, next. Right. Wow. So we pretty much wrote the new rhymes for it that same night, though. So
Jailhouse, Cool Rock, Jailhouse Rap is like one of the earliest music videos of all time.
Yes. For hip hop, yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Can you tell us, like, how did you guys even get into a jail cell?
We shot that video on Rikers Island.
That's a great question. Yo, Jeremy, that's a great question. I didn't even think about that yet.
Yo, are you
serious?
How
did y'all get into Rikers? How did you get into Rikers?
Is that public knowledge?
You shot that at Rikers Island?
Shot in Rikers Island.
Wow.
And, we started. Yeah, they cleared out some of the cell blocks, and at the time we had two hit songs, so
right,
it was easy.
Yeah.
I mean, the cell,
right.
Yeah, the prisoners was like they welcomed it.
Right.
On it, so we started and we shot it like for like maybe a day, and yeah, we got out of there. The prisoners had a riot.
Wow.
Yeah, and I'm just playing. We shot it in a day. So it came off pretty. And we did a show in Rikers.
What?
Just to please the prisoners. We did a show in Rikers like the next week after we shot the video. We went back there and did a show.
Oh, wow.
How did that go over?
That's pretty good. We was held hostage for like 10 days in there. had to send the National
Guard. Other than that, it was fine.
Other than that, it was no problem.
This guy's amazing. I swear to God. How did you... I got to ask a few questions here. So we've actually inducted Charlie Stettler into the museum.
Okay.
He was inducted with DJ Scribble during COVID, I think, as it were.
Okay.
Tell us, what was it like, winning the contest... there's a little bit of controversy because you were the Disco 3, and then from what I understand, Charlie was like, "No, you shall be the Fat Boys." Like, can you tell us how the naming worked out?
people was demanding the Fat Boys. And they was like, "Well, can we get the Fat Boys to perform?" And so one night we went past a marquee with our name on it. It said Disco 3 featuring the Fat Boys. And so we kind of looked at one another like, how many damn groups are there?
Who are them?
Two groups. We're Fat Boys. So Charlie.
We got to meet those guys.
We got to meet those guys. And Charlie kind of said, you know what? I can't market the Disco 3 name.
Right.
Mind you, Disco had played out.
Right.
What, 78?
Right,
like
right.
So he couldn't market the name, and it was so close to a rap group called the Disco 4 anyway. But we were so naive to the fact that we knew there was a Disco 4, but we were like, well, it's three of us and four of them, so they're not going to get mad at us. So, that's how naive we were to everything.
Yeah.
So he couldn't market the name Disco, so he said, you got a hit song called Fat Boys, and we named you Fat Boys, and, we fought against it. And we had a big name change party at Roseland Ballroom.
I remember Roseland.
Name change party? No, people don't know. Cool Rock Ski, you just dropping knowledge. Hold on.
Let's go.
You had a name change party. Who came to this party, and was everyone like, yes?
Who was hot in the industry at that time in hip hop or R&B, whatever. I mean, it was sold out. It was crazy.
Roseland's a big place.
Had anyone else ever changed their name in hip hop? Are these the first people to ever change their name in hip hop?
Nah, you gotta remember, Charles Stettler is like the Don King, Bottom Billy of hip hop. I mean, he'll do some zany things. So the name, and he's a hell of a promoter.
Yeah, he is.
Or was one.
Yeah, he is.
And
shout out Charles Stettler.
That was the big name change party from Disco 3 to Frat Boys, and anything we did was over the top when it came to Charles Stettler, because he didn't know how to do things in a subtle kind of way. Everything with him had to be, well, if Kool Rock's going to the store, let's have him go to the store sitting on the elephant and let him, you know, that kind, you know, something crazy.
Right.
So everything with him was just so zany. It wasn't what Russell Simmons would do. They was the total opposite, you know what I mean?
Right. It really took things to a whole nother level. I would say, I recall Flash and them was called Flash and the 3 MCs, and then they became the Furious Four and Furious Five. So I'll say that was probably the first name change that we could think of. But you guys probably had the most radical, impactful name change, because that really opened up a whole nother can of worms. Even in the aspect of thinking about hip-hop as being very fun. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah. I mean, that's what it was all about. I think he didn't want to go down the lane. Listen, we're from East New York, Brooklyn, so it was easy for us to rap about our surroundings. You know what I'm saying? I mean, it was like living. It was like living in Beirut when we was coming up. And by the time the crack era hit, it was like living in Afghanistan. You know what I'm saying? So it was crazy out there.
Yeah.
So it would have been easy for us to rap about our surroundings, but I think our upbringing was kind of different. We weren't from the streets. We weren't tough guys.
Right.
You know, we knew tough guys, but we weren't tough guys.
Hello.
So we didn't go down that path, because that's not who we were. So, you know, we were into partying, into doing what Sugar Hill Gang was doing, Flash and Furious Five was doing.
Yep.
So we was into just rapping and having fun.
Making music, man. Making it happen.
You know, the Fat Boys had an impact on American culture that I dare say was almost greater than in almost every other rapper in the early 80s. And it's because their crossover appeal, right? Like Sugar Hill Gang reached so many ears because, you know, you guys were serving it on the platter they wanted it.
Oh,
the
Fat Boys, it was palatable. Yeah.
The Fat Boys did the same thing.
That's why I said at the top of the show. Their impact to the culture,
it's really
on a global level.
Yeah,
they cut through the mustard, man.
And I gotta say, even before Run DMC,
absolutely no,
the Fat Boys were known. I
remember clearly,
right,
knowing their presence. I know what they look like. I know what they sound like. I understood their antics. I mean,
guess why?
Yeah,
guess why? In part, Kool Rock Ski. You guys were amazing musicians, but you guys were also in films like Crush Groove.
That's what I'm trying to say.
They had their own film, Disorderlies, which, by the way, is like one of my favorite films of all time. I just want you to know, anyone who says that's a B-written, man, that's a great film.
Classic film.
It's classic.
Is that Ralph Bellamy or Don Ameche? Which one was that in the movie? Disorderly
Order. That's Ralph Bellamy.
Ralph Bellamy. See? Do I know what I'm talking about? Do you see what I'm saying?
He knows.
I'm down with you, baby.
What's that like, man? What are you, like 20 years old? And you're not even. How old are you in Disorderlies?
Going on 20. Going on 20.
Yeah. So you're a 19-year-old kid in a major Warner Brothers
picture. Let me tell you, that actor, my man is like Hollywood royalty.
You mean the old dude?
Yes.
Yeah.
No. Hollywood royalty.
Yeah.
So for him, that was groundbreaking.
To be in that.
For him to say yes to doing a movie with them.
That's true.
Yeah.
Because he was a serious actor.
He was one of the greats in the history of Hollywood. Am I right or wrong? In the history of Hollywood. And for him to say yes to a movie like that with a form of music that was still very new, he was shocked.
That's true. That's true. Fun fact, Ralph. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
What's his name? What's Cramden's name?
Jackie Gleason.
Yeah.
No, the other one. Art Carney.
Art Carney. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Art Carney was supposed to be. Ralph Bellamy's part.
Don't do that.
Art Carney was supposed to be the old rich guy.
What happened?
Yeah. Art Carney wanted. I think he wanted too much money.
Right.
He wanted too much money. So Ralph Bellamy was chosen, and
he killed it.
Ralph didn't know. Yeah, he didn't know anything.
Nothing
about who he had the no hell clue. He was.
Right, he was there for the check. He was there for the check.
He had no clue.
He was there
but
for the check.
But he said he told our manager Charlie one day. He said, "I don't know who these guys are." He said, "But they're so down to earth because for them to have their own movie, they're not walking around like movie stars."
Yeah.
He said, "But I can't understand a damn word they're saying because they talk so much slang." You know, so much
so, that's a good story. Funny.
Oh man.
But he was really cool. He was really cool.
I'm telling you, anybody that knows Ralph Bellamy, go back and check out the history of Ralph Bellamy. Some of the movies he made are iconic. Iconic. So yeah, that was big. That was big. Yeah. Yes, awesome, man.
Definitely. Good.
Well done too, by the way.
Cool, Rockski. Let me tell you something. We could sit here and talk with you for many, many hours.
Yes.
But I want to ask you to do something before we let you go. Please, right now, live on radio, give us a drop and promote your performance and induction on October 28th in Washington, D.C. for the National Celebration of Hip Hop, please?
Yo, what up? This is Cool Rock Ski from the original hip-hop rap group, The Fat Boys. And come check me out October 28th in Washington, D.C. as I get inducted into the National Hip-Hop Museum.
Yes.
Hey.
I'm going to be the place to be.
Yeah.
Beautiful. You are the best.
Thank you, man.
Thank you.
We will be in touch with you because you have a lot of great things coming your way. Cool Rock Ski. Congratulations from everyone at the National Hip Hop Museum.
Especially the executive director. Especially. Thank you. Really appreciate you coming out.
Thank
hey, man.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks out.
Thank you, man. Seriously.
Thank you. We'll see you soon.
Peace.
Okay.
All right.
Peace.
All right.
Well, before we go into You Must Learn, why don't we get a little bit of the hands of God lubricating your earballs?
Come on down. Wow, that's a little weird. Anyway.
Oh, boy.
Get ahead there, RBI.
We'll be back.
We'll be back.
That's G Theater. Stay with us. We're having fun. RBI, the hands of God.
Yo, what's up, y'all? This is Curtis Blow. Just want to give a shout out to DJ RBI. Do your thing, baby. All right, represent that real hip hop.
And you know they can never be whack. The fat boys are bad. Do you like the fat boys? Fat boys are bad. And you know they can never be whack. The fat boys are bad. Do you like the fat boys? As if he were a snack, I'll eat and eat and drink.
drink and drink, and I'll tell you one thing, my breath don't stink, because the beat's so funky like a big fat monkey, and it tastes so good like an almond joy, because I'm thinking bad, mean and bold, because my name is Mark and D, and I'm
Yeah, this is Hammer Time, putting it down with my dog DJ RBI. You know what it is.
We're back. Marcus gives us a nice little countdown. 3, 2, 1. And we're back. Yes, Marcus, I know we're back.
Rest in peace,
Master
Prince
G Theater.
Marky G, by the way.
Yes, rest in peace.
And Buff. Right. Rest in peace to both of them.
Yes.
We lost Prince Marky D recently.
Yes, we did.
But what's really amazing is if you guys come out on October 28th, Rozelle, the amazing Rozelle, will be performing and beatboxing with and for Kool Rock Ski.
That's going to be cool.
So you might want to check that out.
I might be there.
I sure hope you are. Every single show, we like to educate people in a segment.
We call.
We do a segment.
Learn.
Yes. Ha. Yeah. You must learn.
I've missed that.
Just like I told you.
You must learn.
I just assume that's what they're saying there.
You must learn.
Okay.
All right.
You must learn about MC Light. Because it's her birthday. So happy birthday,
happy
MC Light.
Yeah.
Let me tell you, MC Light's reputation and legacy is not paper thin.
No, it
you
is
see,
not.
You see what I did there? Okay. Nobody else did, but it's okay. My guy got me.
Nah, that was slick. That was slick. Bars.
Right? Pause. Okay. Pause.
Wow.
Bars.
Full homo. Thank you. Okay. So MC Light is an American rapper, disc jockey, and entrepreneur. Wow, I didn't know she was a DJ.
Oh, yeah.
She's considered one of the top female rappers of all time. And she first gained fame in the 80s because of her solo albums. But her debut album, Light as a Rock, is really what put her on the map with the single 10% diss and Paper Thin that I just
tried
to. Yeah, okay. So in 1989, she joined the super group Stop the Violence Movement. OK, Okay, on the single Self Destruction.
Yes, you did.
Which actually ended up being a number one single on the Billboard chart. But let's be honest with ourselves. MC Lyte is so much more than a female MC.
Totally.
In my humble opinion, I believe that she and people like Queen Latifah are the epitome of what women strive to be in the hip-hop industry,
100%.
Which is notoriously cruel to women.
Let me say one thing real quick.
Please.
She's my personal... I think she's the greatest. I think she's the greatest because she's done it all.
I agree with
versus
you.
Versus any other... Now, I hate to make it gender-specific like that. I hate doing that, but if we're going to go there, she's done it all. She has the club records. She has the street records.
Yes.
She has the freestyle records. She has the topical records. And she got battle joints. Like, she's the one MC I can say that actually went through a very, very fierce battle and went back and forth a few times. It wasn't a couple of lines here and there. She put some joints out.
Yeah, she really, and she put them out at a time where the industry was so dominated by men.
Yeah, and that's the other thing about it, too. Not only dominated by men, but dominated by some of the greatest MCs of her era. That's the Rakim, Kane, KRS, DOC, Chuck D, G-Rap era. Yes. You know what I'm saying?
Well put.
And she made it through that and actually did collaborations with people that you would never expect, like RBI was saying. Who is one of those people? Rest in peace to Sinead O'Connor.
Yes, indeed.
She collaborated with Sinead O'Connor. She collaborated with Will Smith, Mary J. Blige, Jay-Z, Moby, Aerosmith, Beyonce, Will I Am.
Brandy.
Brandy, just to name a few. She's won many, many, many awards, but I want to cite one of her most recent awards that I attended. And that was last year at the Recording Industry Association of America, where Yo-Yo did a very personal induction ceremony and then threw to Missy Elliott, who was on screen with the most beautiful words and celebratory, congratulatory video for MC Lyte.
Wow.
So in honor of MC Lyte's birthday, happy birthday,
happy
but
birthday
in honor of
Lyte.
All amazing
strong,
women,
like,
you know how
we salute you.
You know how I felt. We got a history. We go way back from back in the day. I've known you from the beginning, and you're amazing. So thank you.
And shout out Brooklyn, because she came out on First Priority Records, which was the very first hip-hop record label out of Brooklyn.
Okay.
So shout out Nate Robinson, First Priority Records, and Milk D.
Okay.
Yes. Done.
All right. Good?
Good? Need a bell?
We're good.
Ding, ding, ding. You got that done?
Out. Okay. That's it.
All right. So, we're back at D Theater. We're going to keep this show going. And, you know, we got a lot of good things going on in this show.
Can I throw a light joint on real quick?
One second.
There you go. That's a good idea.
1 second. Hold on. Wait. Let's throw it to the DJ.
Throw it to the DJ, MC Lyte. When we come back from this MC Lyte song, let's get them healthy.
Yes.
Let's get a segment. Stay tuned.
As if they were stupid, take the same beat and loop it 50 times. times, why not? That other group did. It's idiotic, average and robotic. I keep it real. My mental thick like a Harley click. I got them singing while Marley hits. They don't want to wait in vain, but I work for all the joy and the pain. Come hard when I hit. Hot damn, you know the name, right?
Lock this down like it's supposed to be. The pioneers, Wonder Years, L-Y-T-E. Oh yeah, she's back. The industry need that. Now pay attention to her. I told y'all to listen to her. Yeah, like she's back. The female G rapping in the limelight. Baby girl, get your mind right.
My name
right.
Is like right. It's on you. It's on you. But do it like this. Pass on the insight. Teach a seat about light. And how I was the first female to smash the mic. Yeah, no. I speak the facts of life. While a whole lot of others was crap on the mic. Still showing MCs what cash look like. From the Jetta to the Porsche to the Navi, I'm tight. What I got is hot, you can have it too. Praise God, work hard, all you have to do. I was born to be the light, to give the spark in the dark. Spread the truth to the youth, the ghetto Joan of Arc. It's sad, these kids put you at the head of your throne. All you give them back is raps about your bones. In your whip, studio in your home. Well, who cares, cause your dummies all sound like clones. It's the mystery to me how you got this far. Can't read, can't even count the miles on your car.
Lock this down like it's supposed to be. The pioneers, Wonder Years, L-Y-T-E. Oh yeah, she's back, the industry need that. Now pay attention to her, I told y'all to listen to her. Yeah, like she's back, the female G-rapper in the limelight. Baby girl, put your mind right.
My name
right.
Is like, right. It's on you.
Oh, and we're back. We're back. That's more time.
Yo, this show is ridiculous. But hey, every single
it's
week,
real though. It's
CLB
real.
CLB and Master G like to keep them healthy in a segment they call.
Say you are what you eat. So I strive to eat healthy. My goal in life is not to be rich or wealthy. Because true wealth comes from good health and wise ways. We got to start taking better care of ourselves. Be healthy, y'all.
Be healthy. Hey.
Hey, Master G.
What's happening? CLB.
Yeah, you got it. You have us laughing over here.
Just doing my job.
Always a good time.
Just doing my job. Mm-hmm.
It's good to have you in town.
It's good to be in town. I've been ripping and tearing and ripping.
You have.
Oh, my.
I can't believe I missed your performance, though.
Oh.
At, with the was it 49ers?
Next time you want to perform at a giant soup like football halftime show, maybe just like, you know, shoot a
say
brother
something.
A text.
Yeah.
Yeah, like how
maybe
about
just
you?
Like, hey.
Let some people know.
Oh, well, hey, you know. I'm on TV.
I figured, you know, why not? What the heck? So, yeah, I've been ripping and tearing and thankful. You know me, I'm always thankful and grateful for everything. The show, you guys, you know, my great team, Sugar Hill team, my Adonis Entertainment, all the things that we got going on, the museum that I am the exec. Oh, no.
Yeah, so, you know, I've been keeping up with your activity
yes.
with Sugar Hill Gang and,
yes.
you know, congrats on everything.
Thank you.
What comes to mind, though, is
yes.
your fitness.
Yeah.
I think of stamina and endurance.
Yeah.
How do you maintain
good question.
Such good stamina doing all these performances, traveling all over the world?
True. No, it's a good question. I mean, you know, as everybody knows, I'll be 62 in January. So I'm not a spring chicken, you know. I'm a little bit of a rooster.
A seasoned chicken.
I wanted to say something funny
don't do
to
it.
That,
don't
but there's
do
like
it.
Nothing.
Don't do it. Don't
no,
do
there's
it.
Nothing funny to say because like I don't look this good at 42. This dude's
I'm a rooster,
62.
You see?
Okay.
I'm a rooster.
Okay.
I'm not a spring chicken. I'm a rooster.
Gotcha.
Okay. Anyway.
Show's going left every time.
At any rate, there's a great question. First of all, I am a firm believer in consistency being the key to anything. Love, work, DJing, pissing me off, you know, anything.
Yeah.
So that's the first thing. I've been a part of fitness. I've been a fitness person. I am a gym rat. I have been a gym rat. I've never not. I started lifting strength training in the 90s. I was always calisthenics and, you know, that kind of thing as a kid. Then I got into strength training when I was in my late 20s and early 30s.
Okay.
And I've done that. I've never not. You know, there's some people that have said, that say, you know, well, I stopped working out for 2 years. I've never done that. I've always worked out from the time I got introduced to, you know, free weights and that whole situation till to this day. As a matter of fact, when I'm finished here, that's where I'm going. I'll be in the gym tonight.
That's impressive.
Well, it is what it is. You know, the thing is, and I'm saying that for a reason. You can't expect to get long-term results doing spurts of anything. Okay? Like, if you're working out for 6 months, but you want your lifestyle to change, that's right, right?
Right.
That's the coin. If you want, you know, I'm working out for 6 months, but I want the rest of my life to be good, that's not going to happen. So yeah. What happens is you have to stay consistent. So one of the first thing is I'm always working out.
Okay.
You know, if I go to a city and I get to that city the day before the show, that morning, let's say I got a call time to be ready to go to the venue at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, 8 o'clock in the morning, I'm in the gym. You know, I either get an hour or an hour and a half workout. I call it my pre-show workout.
Yeah.
Where I do 30 minutes of strength training and 30 minutes of cardio. I do the strength training to continue to take out the toxins and continue to keep the density in the shape. And then I do 30 minutes of cardio for that exact thing, to be able to have the wind and open up my lungs before I go on stage to be able to do what it is that
to
I
prepare.
Do.
To prepare, yeah.
Yes. The other thing is that I subscribe to as many naps as you possibly can get.
Ooh.
Right. So the secret to traveling, time change travel, because like for example, a couple of weeks ago, I was in London. I came back from London. I went to Grand Rapids. I left Grand Rapids. I went to LA. I left LA. I went to Italy. I came back from Italy and came back to America.
See, this is what I'm talking about. I'm tired just listening to it.
And we did anywhere from, let's say, a 10-minute show to a 90-minute show in those different
wow.
situations.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is you must always stay conscious of your endurance. And the way that you ensure endurance is to open up your lungs. You have to open up your lungs. You have to make okay. sure that you breathe. And then you breathe. Don't breathe from your throat. Breathe from your chest. Use your diaphragm.
Okay.
So you inhale and
most
then
people
exhale.
Don't breathe fully.
I know
fully.
That. Most people try. They start yes. from here.
Yes.
And this is part of the reason why they never really get a clear path mm-hmm. and they never have that opportunity
to
be
point.
Able. It is a key point. So, yeah. So those are the things. So those are two main things. The other thing is, try to limit the things that are not necessarily the best things to put in your body.
Right.
Now, I just happen to be a person that doesn't smoke. I don't drink. That's just my own personal preferences.
Yeah.
I never drank. I smoked cigarettes when I was very young. I haven't smoked a cigarette in over 20-something years.
Mm-hmm.
I know that that's almost impossible to do, you know, especially in the entertainment business. So what I try to encourage people to do is do it in moderation.
Very, very true.
Because, see, the older you get, go ahead and ring it. Thank you. The older you get, the harder it is to recover from whatever it is that you do.
Church.
Okay. If you were, let's say you were a heavy drinker when you were 20,
you can't
be a heavy drinker in your 30s and your 40s.
This is why I had to let go of the drink.
Hey. Wait, hold yeah. on. You actually said something that's like really important.
Yes.
And I don't think a lot of people realize that. Mm. If you smoked,
right,
like I smoked too,
right,
you can't just keep doing that.
No.
If you did anything, if you were a sweet
whatever
tooth,
you, yes,
you got to stop. If you drank,
whatever,
yeah,
whatever you did,
if you keep doing it though, guaranteed to not be
no.
here.
Right. See, when things start falling off on your body, that's when you start understanding that what it is that you're doing is you're not doing the things that you should be doing based on where you're at in your life.
See, the word that's coming to mind is consistency, yes, because that is key.
Yes.
Also, discipline.
Yes.
Because to be consistent, we must be disciplined.
But let me say this, because I understand, again, see, I'm what you call like the every man's conscience. Even though I'm in a high-profile situation, I have the every man's conscience. I know that it's difficult to not smoke, not drink, work
yeah.
out all over the place, travel. I know that it's difficult.
Especially when it's used as escapism, right?
So what I try to do is I try to give you a moderate or a modified version of my version.
Word.
So that's why I say what you should do is just take a little bit less of whatever it is that you're doing and start with that.
Right.
So let's say you drink 4 nights out of the week. Just take 1 night out of the week to not drink.
Right.
you know, and then do that for a while.
Start in incrementally.
Do it in increments. Yeah. You say, you know, so because let's say you don't work out. Okay, fine. Don't work out, but listen, do something to get your heart rate going. Do something to clean out your body. Even if it's going to, you know, having a medical procedure that has to do with your intestinal parts of your body. I don't want to get into those gory details, but do something that's going to replenish and refresh your insides.
For sure.
Because those toxins, again, I'm 62 years old, so I got a 62-year-old digestive system. Okay?
Right.
That's a pretty old
digestive system. It's a sobering thought.
Think about that.
It is. It is a sobering thought.
That's a pretty old digestive system.
Mm.
So I, at this age, have to be aware of, I have to give it more attention than
more
I
care.
Did. Exactly. So wherever you're at, yeah, just treat it like it belongs.
That keeps it in perspective. Yes. And I think that, for me, is the key point that, yes, you just said. Just being aware that our system,
yeah,
is reflective of the number of years we've been on this earth.
It is what it is.
And we act accordingly.
And that's and I promise you, no, you're not going to necessarily be able to work out all over the world and train four and five and train after you've been
right
a full day. I get that. But just understand where you are at in your life and try to do whatever you can to modify the situation to help with your endurance and help with your stamina. And I'm, yeah, just going to do something real quick here. The other thing is, like, the male of the species, you know, as you get older, your testosterone level decreases. So it makes it harder to have certain things happen in your life. And I'm just, yes, going to put that out to the universe.
It goes on both sides, too. Exactly. Women deal with this, exactly, issue as well.
A lot of it has to do with the artificial substances that you put into your body.
Facts. Yes.
So if you're having an issue with, let's say, making things happen when you need them to happen, you might want to pull back on some of those artificial stimulants, because a lot of those artificial stimulants are depressants. And when you're younger, a depressant doesn't mess with you. But when you're older, it's cutting through like mustard, and it's affecting the things that you need to be real when it's time for them to be real.
Are you referring to things like energy drinks or things like workout supplements?
I'm talking about alcohol. I'm talking about cigarettes. I'm talking about heavy medication. I'm talking about all these different things that people think.
Processed food.
They see, there you go. I'm talking about all these different, yeah, things, man, that, again, when I'm younger, I can do anything. Man, when I was a kid, I
ate, my gosh,
hamburgers and french fries.
With stomachs of steel.
Come on, man. I got a superhero stomach.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Now, man, let me mess around and get a piece of beef. Man, I got to go to the bathroom. Are you kidding me?
Let me tell you, I slowed my drinking down,
yes,
for said reason, yes, getting older, because I enjoy the drink. Yes. However, I had to slow it down.
It's real. It's real.
It just not it's working real. With my system. Yeah. About a month, maybe less than a month ago, I decided to hang out with a friend. I had one cocktail. It took me 2 hours to sip it. It took me a week to recover.
Exactly.
Because
you really don't understand, because after a period of time of putting artificial substance in your body, you, yeah, have no idea how bad they affect,
yeah,
you. And now I'm going to go to my thing. The reason why I don't do those things is because my body is a temple, and I don't want my body to be affected by outward substances. Oh. I want it to be created, and I want it to give the opportunity to trust me, y'all, the things that I could do at 20, I do them better at 60.
You made me want to shake my dreads on that one.
Hey, before we conclude this segment, I want to ask both of you, what do you think is the most important thing you've cut out of your diet that
pork?
You.
Sugar.
Me, it's dairy. I used to be an ice cream addict.
Okay. Mm.
And dairy causes inflammation.
Yeah.
Yes, it does.
Mr. Grape Nuts over there.
We got a couple of health conscious people behind us.
Most
health conscious.
Just junk. A lot of that had to do with not knowing the amount of sugar that in a lot of foods and, mm-hmm, stuff like that.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
Just junk food.
Yeah, certain things they even promote it as like health food, but
it's not. Yeah. Vegan stuff. They're like, oh, it's vegan, so it must be healthy. No, actually, it is not.
No, a lot of it's not.
A lot of sugar. Hey,
it's
Marcus. With your new electric Mustang.
Yes.
What
Here. Pretty profound.
Got one? What have you cut out of your diet that you feel really helpful?
A need for walking. He's got the Mustang now.
Oh, no, I like walking a lot.
He has cut out walking.
I walk a lot. Like, good. I walk a lot.
Good.
It's important. I don't like doing it. Like, I like walking. I like being active.
So you're not a person that food is a gym
wise,
person.
Though,
but food-wise, I try to get away from sugary drinks.
There you go.
Because okay. I try to drink more water because I'm like, I woke up this morning after having a sugary drink yesterday night, and I felt so sluggish. I got to work pushing heavy car, and I'm like, I felt like I don't have energy. I don't have any.
Right.
Get up, and I'm like, I need more water in my diet.
There you go.
The other thing, too, you notice.
Water's paramount. That's very good.
Cutting out sugar, like really doing that, when you taste something that has sugar in it, it hits you like, bam.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
It affects you quicker. Like, when you take it out of your system, and then it's introduced again, you know.
It's like a shock.
It's like, no, I can't. Yeah. It's like, let me put this down.
Yeah. And Marcus made a really good point. A lot of the things that we may be feeling, whether it's fatigue, sometimes even depression, it's simply because we're dehydrated.
No question.
Oh, wow.
Gotta hydrate.
Yeah.
Gotta hydrate. Wow. So, yeah, there you go. So, that's it. You know, the thing is that I try to get people to understand that, like Marcus was saying, even if you're not a person like me that's, you know, I'm going to go to the gym and be in the gym, and you, whatever it is that you could do, you got to do something that replenishes your body. If it's walking, if it's running, if it's bike riding, you know, my brother-in-law, he rides, you know, the bike. He does like 30, 40 miles, whatever the case may be. Yeah, he's one of them guys. They got like the bike crew and that whole thing. He doesn't really go in the gym, but he rides a bike. He looks amazing. You know, he's in his 40s.
Walking, like parking farther away when you go to the grocery store,
there
using the steps.
That See, little things like that.
Exactly.
Take the stairs.
Because that's something that everybody can literally do.
Like, with no
just
problem.
Live your life, you walk.
There you go.
We're going to end on an awkward moment, but it's not really awkward.
Yeah.
It's telling people, I need you to do a drop.
Me?
Yes.
For what?
October 28th. The National Celebration of Hip Hop here in Washington, D.C. Okay. Everyone, come out and check out Sugar Hill Gang.
So look. October 28th, right? October 28th, Sugar Hill Gang, okay? The founding member, Sugar Hill Gang, Master G, myself, and my crew, T-Dynasty, Head Diggity Dog, my man Vashon, Ethiopian King. Oh, and along with them, we're going to do Grandmaster Melly Mel and Scorpio of Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five MCs. We got this thing we call the Supergroup Show. You got to come out on October 28th. If you have not seen Sugar Hill Gang, Melly Mel, Scorpio on stage live together, if you haven't, come see us. October 28th, right here, D.C. It's going down, baby. Yeah. And right now, it's the Master G Theater, and we'll be back with RBI that's going to take us out. Take it away, RBI!
We are out of here.
Peace.